My name is James Green. I'm a professor of Brazilian history and culture at Brown University and the director of the Brown Brazil Initiative. On behalf of the Skidmore family, I would like to thank you all for joining us today to honor the legacy of Thomas Skidmore. People coming, his family, his friends, and his colleagues, to remember Tom as the Carlos Manuel de Cespedes Professor Emeritus of Latin American History at Brown University. Tom came to Brown after a long and illustrious career that took him from Denison University to Harvard, then to Oxford University, where he met his future wife, Felicity Hall, to the University of Wisconsin-Madison, where he spent most of his career and raised three sons, David, James, and Robert. Brown University was very lucky when Tom decided to move to Rhode Island to be an anchor in the Brazilian Studies program along with the Department of Portuguese and Brazilian Studies. We would like to thank the Brazil Initiative, the Brown University Library, the Center for Latin American and Caribbean Studies, the Department of History, and the Department of Portuguese and Brazilian Studies for supporting the organization of this event today, and especially Ramon Stern, the program administrator of the Brazil Initiative, who helped make this and many other activities at Brown possible. The Skidmore family asked me to organize an event that was short and sweet. So I will not extend my own remarks on the influence of Tom Skidmore on my own academic career or the tremendous impact he had on the study of Brazilian history and culture in the United States and in Brazil. However, I still have fond memories of obtaining a copy of his work, his first work, Politics in Brazil, 1930 to 1964, and An Experiment in Democracy, published by the Oxford University Press, when I was in Fortaleza, Ceará, Brazil, in 1976. I had borrowed a copy of the book from a Brazilian professor who had studied at Berkeley, and he actually gave it to me as if it were a dangerous, subversive book that had to be very carefully taken care of, while I was traveling through the Northeast from the Amazon to Rio de Janeiro. And it became my reading adornment while I traveled in my what would become my adopted homeland. I'm not really sure I understood one-tenth of the context, the content of the books, the complexities of Brazilian politics. But this book, which is now a classic, as I read it and reread it, gives me always new insights into the history and culture of 20th century Brazil. I never could have imagined in 1976, while I was traveling on buses en route to Salvador Bahia and then to Rio de Janeiro, that one day would become a friend and colleague of Tom's, as well as that of Felicity, to which he dedicated that book and many others along his career. Among the many people who sent us messages about Tom's passing in this event, it seems fitting to read one brief note sent by Paulo Sergio Pinheiro, a former adjunct professor in international studies at the Watson Institute, who was extremely grateful that Tom Skidmore brought him to Brown for the first time in 1997. Paulo Sergio Pinheiro is an important figure in the defense of human rights. He was the former minister of the Secretariat for Human Rights during the government of Fernando Cardoso, Brazil's representative on the Inter-American Commission on Human Rights, and an important figure defending human rights globally in the United Nations. And I'll quote from his note. Dear Felicity, dear colleagues, students, friends, to remember Tom Skidmore is an easy and agreeable task. His many incarnations, his multiple roles, so many qualities, so many expressions of his acute mind, his generosity towards colleagues and students as a formidable professor, but also in so many foundations and councils, supporting and stimulating new research, new careers in the States and abroad. His sense of humor, an inner element of his intelligence, and the many extraordinary interviews, always to the delight of journalists. His devotion to Brazil, he became the ideal type of Brazilianist, perhaps more than any one of that species. He was the spark that illuminated in two continents the interest for research on the political history of 20th century Brazil. He was a superb analyst of the political juncture, always discovering hidden signals, unexpected trends. Tom was the best fellow traveler of people of African descent, the most eminent and implacable analyst of racism in Brazil of his generation. I am so proud of our friendship of more than 40 years. I am already hearing his Portuguese filled with plenty of idioms, of colloquialisms, interpreting the Florentine disguises of politicians with enormous grace and sensibility. Oh, Tom, how much we miss you. How great you are. You are the top. You are the Arquivo Nacional. You are the Brasiliana. You are the Bahia de Guanabara. You are the top. You are the top. Now, before I pass the word on to the first speaker in today's program, I would also like to recognize the presence today here of Congressman Jean Willis, who represents the state of Rio de Janeiro and is on tour of the United States University. Jean Willis, please just, yeah. This tour is sponsored by the Brown in Brazil Initiative and includes events in Harvard and Princeton and City University of New York and George Washington University. When planning Congressman Willis's trip, I mentioned today's event and he insisted that he be present, as Tom's books were important references in his own personal academic career at the Universidade Federal da Bahia, the Federal University of Bahia. Now, unfortunately, Roger Owen, the A.J. Meyer Professor of Middle Eastern History, emeritus from Harvard University, who shows up in our program, cannot be with us today. In his place, Anthea Wilkinson, Tom's sister-in-law, will read his message. There she is.
Thank you. This is what Roger wrote. What a great pleasure it is to have been asked to lead off this series of reminiscences about the life and work of our dear friend Tom Skidmore, even though I can't be with you all, his family, colleagues, and friends. I can imagine his chuckle from afar when he learnt this event was to be held on the 5th of November, Guy Fawkes Day in England. As a 23-year-old Fulbright scholar at Oxford University, Tom would have witnessed the same November the 5th celebration. The city would have been brightened and banged by bonfires and the traditional firework display to commemorate the preservation of the king and his members of parliament who escaped from being blown up by a Catholic dissident 411 years ago when England still ruled America. I arrived at Magdalen College, Oxford, a year after Tom had left, but I soon caught up with him in Cambridge, Massachusetts. Then, in his later years in Westerly by the sea, we began a series of wonderful conversations, both by letters he dictated to his wife, Bib. You'll get used to that, it's Felicity, we all call her Bib, the family name of Felicity. And better still, by my visits to his book filled room at the nursing home. There he continued to chat to me like an Oxonian, with dry wit, intellectual curiosity, and high spirits, never lapsing into American lecture mode. One effect of his amazing talent for language and mimicry was that he learnt to swear like an Englishman, even to the nurses, who of course all adored him. Tom and I found more and more to share, beginning with the peculiarities of Magdalen College itself. For him, it was very odd and invigorating. The ancient college servants were called scouts and addressed him as Sir, and the ritual of the weekly essays read aloud to teachers called dons. And all this in the shadow of Britain's oldest medieval bell tower at Magdalen, by a park where deer grazed. I also, writes Roger, found Oxford strange after finishing national military service fighting in Britain's last colonial war. Tom loved the fact that our syllabus for politics, philosophy, and economics contained little about the empire, little about ethics and almost nothing about the world after 1914. But there we were in the so-called flower of youth, alive to new experience and strange customs. Tom was forever moved by the magic of archaic Oxford terms such as sconce, buttery, and rustication, which meant you were being sent away for being very naughty. We therefore rejoiced when we had become withered lilies. This was the name for alumni that played upon the flowers on the Magdalen coat of arms. Tom and I also discussed our different roles in developing what was to be called area studies. In his case, an analysis of political and economic structures, first in Germany, then in Brazil. Tom's enthusiasm and scholarship, displayed in weighty volumes on his bookshelves, was always lightened by an inexhaustible sense of fun and frolic. For example, his lively memories of Copacabana Beach. Even at the end of his life, his memory was phenomenal. An encyclopedia which we all consulted, not only about German and Brazilian history. Tom was also an acute observer of the contemporary world, which he absorbed assiduously from the New York Times and the TV news. So farewell, my dear and greatly learned friend, Thomas E. Skidmore, or valet, as we used to say in Oxford Cod Latin. May your books continue to be read with pleasure and profit. May memories of you continue to inform the lives of all those who had the good fortune to know you. And Roger ends by saying, Tom, I miss you badly. Now, I'm going to add a brief envoy of my own. I spent as many as possible of my Oxford vacations and then on holiday from work, first as a Schwägerin and then as a Cunada with Tom and my sister in Berlin, Hamburg, Kiel, La Beur, Barcelona, the Costa Brava, Rio, Salvador Bahia, Brasilia, and São Paulo, not to mention Cambridge, Mass, Madison, and Providence. We shared endless fun. Roger has mentioned that Tom learned to swear like an Englishman, but I witnessed with admiration his cursing in his magnificently powerful voice in German, in Kiel, at a cheating hotel keeper, and then in Brazilian Portuguese at the thundering music from above our apartment in Ipanema. We had great fun dancing in an underground train in Berlin before the wall on New Year's Eve. Then there was more fun in Copacabana, where we went to the Kilche Club with tartan wallpaper. Tom observed that Brazilians were the only people who wore dark glasses in nightclubs. Once Tom and I drank so much on an outing in Madison that we couldn't find the car in the car park. I said nervously, what will Bib say? Without hesitation, he replied, she'll say, have you looked everywhere? An affectionate and typically mischievous allusion to her rigorous logic. Tom never lost this acute and inspired sense of mischief. His 80th birthday party was at the Wesley Nursing Home, where he was then living contentedly, visited there by Bib, my sister, morning and night. The birthday party was a dignified and respectful occasion. Tom presided with his usual charm until the event was drawing to a close. Then he suddenly announced, I have invited an unexpected guest. There was a dramatic pause. And a woman that our family had loathed and hoped we'd forgotten 50 years ago, the name was uttered. My sister and I, who were of course the only people who understood the black joke, first gasped in horror, then wailed with laughter, while the rest of the party looked on in totally baffled silence. Tom surveyed the scene of confusion with satisfaction. Then he said it was time he went back to his books. What a man, what a total fun-making, mischievous delight he was. That's him.
And now it's my pleasure to introduce Peter Smith, Tom's co-editor of the textbook Modern Latin America, and his colleague, and the Simon Bolivar Professor of Latin American Studies Emeritus at the University of California in San Diego.
It is a great honor for me to be here for this glorious and bittersweet occasion. Thomas Skidmore was to me a colleague, friend, mentor, playmate, collaborator, advisor, and co-author. A renowned celebrity in his beloved Brazil, he was also a loyal but skeptical supporter of the Wisconsin Badger football team. I have loved this man for nearly half a century. Tom's office door was always open. That is remarkable. It was an open invitation for any and all. Absolutely open. He loved contact with students, colleagues, anyone and everyone. He was intensely collegial. He was infinitely generous with his time and ideas. There was not a book he didn't love, even though he might have hated it. There was not a conversation he did not enjoy, whether he won it or not. Like most other colleagues, I was quite the opposite. Even if you believe it, posting do not disturb notes on my office door, treating students and colleagues like the cleanup crew in a third-rate motel. How silly of me to do that. How much I could have learned from Tom if I'd sort of peeked outside my door. Tom's curiosity was restless and boundless. While reviewing my own candidacy for a faculty position at Wisconsin, he said he didn't much like the paper I presented at a major professional meeting, but later on he was struck by comments from my peer students at an informal lunch he had, and that was what got me the job at Wisconsin. So I got to Madison, where together with the colonialist John Phelan, we formed a formidable trio of Latin American historians. Tom was our undisputed leader. We thought we were good, really good. And truth to hell, we might have been. This sense of solidarity also shaped our social life, with Felicity Skidmore as chief organizer and administrator. We saw each other all the time. Thanksgiving dinner was always at the Skidmore house, and my now adult sons still relish with humor recollections of Tom slowly and gradually unbuttoning his vest throughout the course of a heroic dinner, until finally they were all open and it was time for the pumpkin pie to arrive. Such delicious memories. I will also never forget the gentle scolding I received from Felicity Skidmore for overpouring my martini glass and underpouring hers. This time in Madison was by far the most enjoyable and perhaps the most productive chapter in my checkered academic career. I shall always treasure it. Life forces pushed us on. John Phelan passed away. I moved to MIT. Felicity and Tom later came to Brown. But even at a distance, Tom and I remained close. We continued to work together on a textbook, originally construed simply as a product of and selling point for the Wisconsin History Program. We had no inkling that it would become somewhat of a phenomenon, now heading into 35 plus years and a ninth edition. Now that Jim Green has joined the team, the book and the project will take on new life. Strange things can happen. But let us remember that Tom Skidmore was the original protagonist for this entire project. Modern Latin America is a part of his personal legacy. I shall miss this man. We shall miss this man. This accomplished scholar with a wicked sense of humor and the always open door. Tom loved life. Let us celebrate that love. Tom kept his doors open. Let us open all our doors. Let us join him in this endeavor, and let us keep the doors open forever. Thank you.
Steve Stern and Florencia Mallon were Tom's colleagues at the University of Wisconsin for more than 20 years. And Steve, who is the Alberto Flores Galindo and Hildel Professor of History at University of Wisconsin, will share a few words with us. Steve.
I need to find the few words first. Maybe. One of the things that Tom Skidmore told me, you know, because as has already come out, he was kind of irreverent, said, Steve, let me tell you something. One day I went into class. I'd forgotten my notes at home. Here's the thing I don't want you to repeat to anyone else. It was better. So that's Tom. As Jim, I love the Portuguese accent on the Alberto Flores Galindo and Hildel. Portuguese is so much prettier. It's better. And, you know, the thing about Tom, who was a great scholar and also Mr. Brazil, is that I don't know how many of you, is there anyone here who ever heard Tom do an academic talk, whether a lecture to a class or a seminar or at a conference, when he in English in the United States, in which he didn't break out into Portuguese? The man couldn't go 5 minutes without the love of Brazil just sweeping in there. It was great. That was Tom. He was Brazil, as well as many other things. I want to mention just briefly that the Luso Brazilian Review, which Tom edited among the many different things that he did, is going to have a special number devoted to Tom's legacy and in honor of Tom. And I just got word from one of the editors that they've just done the final pass-through on it. So it should be coming out soon. So stay tuned. Tom had such range. You could see that in the books in his home and in the books that he produced. Think about it. The person who writes the first of two volumes that would be the classic books, Politics in Brazil, and then the one on the military dictatorship, the sequel to that book that came out, that constitute the best two-volume set you can still go to understand the political history of modern Brazil in its widest social context. And in between them writes Black into White, all about race in Brazil. He just had a phenomenal range that you could just see in a conversation or in the books that he produced, leaving aside, of course, the global history with Peter and then with Jim of modern Latin America. He was just a tremendous scholar, and he would bring that into the way that he mentored his colleagues and his students, and I think anybody who traipsed through the Skidmore home, because he had that magnificent library. But he also had that wit. You know, the kind of wit that comes from somebody who was a debater and could think on his feet, which he was when he was back in Ohio. So I'm going to tell you my favorite wit story about Tom Skidmore and then go on to another. This was because it was a wit that punctured the conceits we have, the pretensions we have, and just goes straight to the heart of an issue. In the history department, and I apologize to the Skidmore family, we did a little event in Madison, and I told this story, but it's too good to pass up for the rest of you. from time to time, history departments, you know, colleagues relate to each other mainly through committees and students they teach and things of that sort. But since we think we're intellectuals, we sometimes pretend that we want to talk about ideas together. It's a good thing. And so the history department, at one point, because we all had these closed doors, decided that we would open the door and do a brown bag lunch and talk about something. We had no time to read anything extra. So we would just pick a topic, a one-word topic, and get together and have lunch and talk about it. So one week, this was Gerda Lerner and myself and a couple of other people doing it. One week, the topic was literacy. And Gerda, who decided she would lead this discussion, said, you know, can anybody think of any society where literacy has not been an advantage? Only a half a nanosecond passed before Tom said, New Jersey. Well, Gerda recovered, so did we. But that was Tom, kind of unforgettable. His irreverence also extended to himself. One of the things that I loved about the program that Tom and Peter recruited me into at Wisconsin when I joined the faculty, and that Tom mentored Florencia and me into when Florencia joined the faculty, was that we took collective responsibility for the formation of all the students. And we had quite a few students to keep track of. And I'll never forget the moment when Tom, you know, we would review how the students were doing, what do they need intellectually, what do they need financially, who is going to be the person who would follow up and could read them psychologically and all that sort of stuff. But sometimes we lost track, true confession. So Tom once leaned into me, I'm not going to say who the student was, and said, you know that Dreg Snyder, does anyone know if he graduated yet? It was his way of saying that, you know, we pretended to keep track, but what the heck, sometimes we lost track. That's why we needed each other. I think that Tom had a tremendous ability to read people. He wasn't just a tremendous historian. He could read people, and I think that's one reason he thrived in Brazil and in Latin America, because that human connection is so important. It happened to me in the story. Again, I apologize for repeating it, but I always remember it very fondly when Tom and the history department hired me. And I had very protective parents. They were first-generation Americans. And so I was visiting them in San Antonio, Texas, and Tom called. My father was a tailor, didn't know who this person was. So their immediate instinct was to say that I didn't exist, I wasn't there, because it's probably, you know, the man trying to come after me. And so Tom understood what was going on with this kind of defensive, hostile, slightly scared first generation people in the United States. And he said, Mr. Stern, talking to my father, I'm the one who hired him. I said, oh, he's right over here. And when we would review how the students were doing intellectually, what they needed financially, et cetera, we also reviewed their psychological state of mind. It will shock some of you to understand that students can be a little bit anxious and that part of mentoring them has to do with reading their psychological state of mind. Well, the clear leader who always saw first what was going on and what was needed was Tom Skidmore. That was Tom. He was a tremendous historian, a great teacher, very, very funny, but at the expense of all of us and the conceits that all of us take into life. And I think that's what made him so much fun to be around. That's what made him so mischievous, if you will. And that's why we're going to miss him tremendously for the work that he did and for the fun that he brought to life. So as we would say on the Spanish side of Latin America, Tomás Skidmore, siempre presente. Thank you.
One of Tom's colleagues at Madison was Ken Sachs, who later moved to Brown University and is a professor of history and classics. Ken, there you are.
Thanks, Jim. And before I begin, I just want to do a shout out to Jim for organizing this event. But far more than that, as everyone knows, when the time that Jim came here, he was an extraordinary supporter of Tom and Felicity, and has done so much to keep Tom's legacy alive, not just his memory, but his legacy. And Tom's presence at Brown will never die because of what Jim has done. So I think that's, I'd like to honor him publicly. And now I'm going to turn my notes the right way. Maybe I'll get my glasses too, what do you think? I arrived in Madison, Wisconsin in 1976 as a freshly minted PhD. In fact, I was 1 month past defending my dissertation. And I was pretty scared. In fact, Peter Smith is here, so it reminds me of the fact that about 3 months into being in Madison, Peter called me to the chair's office. He was the chair. And he said, Ken, you know, you're allowed to go to department meetings. It's a true story. The department was packed with sensational scholars, just people whose books I had read in college and was trembling to see that I was sitting next to it, not at department meetings, but in other places at lunch. And I was a bit more than a little intimidated, but nobody welcomed me more than Tom. He was so friendly to everybody. As Peter said, his door was always open. He always had a smile on his face. He was always engaging. And you never felt that he judged your ideas or judged what you said. He was just eager to hear you. I soon learned that he was not just a fantastic and humble scholar, but was a great, great colleague as well. Anytime I served with him, and the honor of serving with him on a search committee or a tenure committee, I realized that nobody read as much as Tom, and nobody remembered everything as much as Tom. He always offered extraordinarily level judgments about candidates. Tom was a walking no BS zone. He told you what he thought all the time. It was well-grounded, always important. And yet, as has been said before, nobody could gossip better than Tom. The meeting was over, and then the gossip began. Jane and I eventually moved down the street from Tom and Felicity. And then we became bounded, as two families cannot be bound in this world any tighter, because our favorite babysitter became their daughter-in-law. And so we are linked forever with the Skidmores. Everyone knew that Tom and Felicity were great neighbors and great citizens, and that Felicity was a super mom, and not just a super mom who could do all the momming that you needed to do while she built her own great professional career, but she took in stray people as well. So we all knew what wonderful neighbors and what wonderful participants they were in Madison. They had a huge impact on the Madison community. I vividly remember standing outside the Humanities Building, which is what it was called then. We probably should have called it the Inhumanities Building. just after Tom took the offer from Brown, and he was telling me how much he'd miss Madison, and I knew that was true, but I also knew how much we would miss Tom and Felicity. Later, after Tom's terrible accident, and after Jane and I followed them to Brown, Tom and Felicity were extraordinarily gracious in welcoming us. As I was being interviewed at Brown, I emailed Tom and said I'd like to meet some students. The next thing I knew, Tom had arranged a large table of students at the faculty club to talk with me. And every time I asked them a question, all they would say was, well, Professor Skidmore does this, Professor Skidmore does that. That was perfectly understandable. And despite his infirmities, Tom remained extraordinarily engaged and in great humor. At his retirement luncheon, when it was his turn to speak, he did sort of a David Letterman number. He said, the top 10 reasons why I decided to retire. And he went through the list, and when he got to number one, he said, the number one reason why I've decided to retire was last semester, I almost gave a student a C. And I realized what the summer would bring to me if I did that. Well, you know, as I go through my own career and I see a poor student, I think to myself, what would Tom have done? And I bump it up to a B. Even when Tom was largely housebound and then bedridden, it was a delight to visit him. He read everything that's been said, had a strong opinion about everything. And every time I went to visit him, I had to prep by reading the New York Review of Books and faking the fact that I might have actually read the book as well as the review. Peter said that Tom loved UW football, and he did. In fact, the very last time I saw Tom, he was wearing a UW football t-shirt. He was passionate about sports and the Badgers especially. And Tom, if you're listening, I want you to know the last time I checked, the Badgers were up 21-7 with 8 minutes to go in the fourth quarter. Well, Tom and I were in very different fields and had very different lives, but I can attest that no one loved the Academy more, no one gave back to the Academy more, and no one graced the Academy more than did Tom Skidmore. He was an exemplary citizen and a person, an exemplary person in every way, and we miss you enormously.
I would now like to introduce Robert Self, the Mary Ann Lippitt Professor of American History at Brown University and the current chair of the History Department, to say a few words.
Thank you, Jim. As the current chair of the History Department, I'd like to offer the department's collective condolences to Felicity and to the Skidmore family. From both the faculty and the staff. Tom was a beloved figure among both. I came to the department shortly after Tom's retirement and therefore did not enjoy the benefit of knowing him as a colleague. But his legacy when I arrived was palpable, and it lives today in the department's fantastically strong Latin American program, which attracts some of our strongest PhD students to this day. I also came to deeply appreciate Tom and Felicity's generosity to the department after Tom's retirement, particularly with regard to the graduate students. Another beneficiary of that generosity is the Brown University Library, to which Tom donated his personal library and papers in 2006, which contains, as some of you have noted, some 6,000 books in both English and Portuguese, and that include both 19th and 20th century titles that he collected over more than three decades. My remarks today are meant to be quite short, but in preparation for my contribution to this celebration of Tom Skidmore's life, I did what each of us in the Academy would perhaps least wish our colleagues to do. I read through book reviews of Tom's books over the course of his career. They are filled with the usual academic argumentation, the praise and disputations, the criticism and assessments, the accolades and the detractions. They are a prose record of a dedicated and prolific professional life. If words on the page live longer than morals are allowed, I hope we can lift a few of those words from his reviews and let them speak, or rather reviews of his books, and let them speak on Tom's behalf this afternoon. Astute, encyclopedic, these are from the reviews. Lively, authoritative, essential, remarkably comprehensive, judicious, extensive, classic, best, major, instructive, monumental, the envy of other academics, impressive, timely, cultural sensitivity, excellent, beautiful. After a lifetime in any profession, who among us would not be thrilled to know that such words would be attached to our name for all time? On behalf of the History Department, thank you very much for joining me and Jim in this celebration of Thomas Skidmore's life. And thank you, Felicity, for allowing me to speak and to express the department's condolences and its great warmth and affection for Tom.
Matthew Gutman is a professor of anthropology at Brown University, and he was also the director of the Center for Latin American and Caribbean Studies, where Tom also had served as director at Brown University. He will be speaking a few words.
Thank you, Jim, and I echo Ken's remarks in terms of the role that Jim has played in keeping Tom Skidmore a very permanent part of this university and scholarship in general. Tom led the Center for Latin American Studies, later named the Latin American and Caribbean Studies, including a shared Title VI for a decade or so. When he arrived from Wisconsin, He brought immediate recognition to Brown as a place of distinguished scholarship and exchanges through conferences he organized and people he brought to Brown, including Fernando Enrique Cardoso, whose tenure as a visiting professor for 5 years here was due in no small measure to Tom's stature in the field, as well as others like Paulo Sergio Pinheiro, who made regular visits. Tom set a tone for high, rigorous productivity, and I swear to God this was in here already, but the word that I keep hearing, and for fun. His inimitable personality, his quick wit, and borderline quip set the tone that helped Brown's Latin American studies thrive under his mentorship for not only Brown faculty and students, including training one of today's leading Brazilianists, Jerry Davila, but also of others who came into his orbit in Providence, like Jeffrey Lesser, then just a rising star. Jerry, of course, is organizing a double session at the AHA this year, I gather, exactly for Tom's students. For all of us affiliated with class in those years, Tom Skidmore was our guru, our sponsor, our nudge to bring sharper intellectual give and take to our community. As an elder with a generous soul, we had to prove our worth to him. Tom was not one for automatically agreeing to anything, except perhaps for his Chardonnay at lunch. I was very impressed as a junior faculty that senior faculty seemed to have drinks at lunch. Tom's keen sense of politics, history, and humor was never more in evidence than the day I drove his old graduate student buddy, Tom Gleason, one of our distinguished historians here at Brown, also a historian of Russia, to see him in Westerly. To hear the two of them riff for a solid hour on current events and personalities, some new biography they'd both read, and the inanities of academia that are always more comical and petty with distance. Well, that was the tag team performance. That tag team performance was a show to behold. And so was Tom in every way. Our thanks go to Felicity and the whole Skidmore family for their love of and engagement with the center and for Brown for the last 30 years. Thank you.
Before some final words by members of the Skidmore family, I would like to call to the podium Harriet Hamasi, Brown University librarian. Excuse me. I apologize, thank you. Nelson Vieira, the University Professor of Portuguese and Brazilian Studies at Brown University, will now share some thoughts with us. Excuse me, Nelson.
Just wasn't reading the script.
Thank you, Jim, I think. Boa tarde, say in Brazil. Felicity, family of Tom, and ladies and gentlemen, colleagues and students. I'm very, really very pleased to be able to not only bring the welcome remarks from my Department of Portuguese and Brazilian Studies, but also having this, you know, moving and friendly opportunity to celebrate Tom's life. I believe that Tom, I've known Tom for many, 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 many years, more than I would care to remember. Not because of him, but just because of the many years. Certainly Tom will forever be remembered as one of the first Brazilianists, a generation of scholars, we all know, who emerged in the 1960s, dedicating, in his case, lifelong scholarly work to our beloved Brazil and Latin America. And his major works, you know, like Politics in Brazil, have been mentioned here this afternoon. And it's important, I think, for us to recognize that, of course, for his generation, he is the illustrious Latin American scholar. This acclaim, this praise, was registered a few years back in 2006 by the BRAZA organization, by bestowing upon him the Lifetime Lifetime Contribution Award. I first met Tom when I was a beginning graduate student. Tom was, this was in the mid-60s. And I met him after he had graduated from Harvard, and also after the years that he had taught at Harvard. And I met him on his way to Brazil on his 3-year postdoc. And I remember looking in with awe at Tom and realizing that before me was a rising star. But I was really impressed not only by his academic demeanor, but this boundless energy that sort of took me aback. And when I spoke with him, you know, he spoke as if he knew me for years. And so while over the years I met Tom at professional meetings, I really didn't get to know him, thinking in terms of that first impression that I had, until his arrival at Brown in 1988. Rather than commenting on Tom's singular, intellectual, and unparalleled academic legacy, so I would like to address briefly Tom's humane legacy as a colleague and friend. Who can fail to remember Tom's life, Tom's infectious laughter, chuckles, and occasional guffaws? But always graced with a certain bonhomie, and that made the moment, the present moment, exciting and pleasurable. Whether it was at a large professional meeting or at a university gathering, conference, committee, or at an intimate dinner at home with Tom and Felicity, Tom's notable gregarious and welcoming nature infused the atmosphere by making everyone feel very welcome, but at the same time, encouraging one to keep intellectually sharp and stay on one's toes. It was that combination of sheer joy and stimulating intellect that I will forever cherish in Tom. I also recall Tom's generosity of spirit, especially when he first came to Brown and told us in Portuguese and Brazilian Studies, and we were just a program at the time, that one of the motives for his move to Brown was his admiration for the good work we were doing in Portuguese and Brazilian Studies. At that time of our uphill struggle and battle, Tom's words were extremely meaningful, for they gave us a much needed professional and psychological boost. 3 years later, we became a department, and Tom shared and celebrated that milestone with us with great, great enthusiasm, and it was a joyful time for us. Another sign of his giving and sharing nature became clear when, despite being the director of Spanish American, Tom knew the difference that in Latin America you also spoke Portuguese. And Tom never failed, despite being the director of Latin American Studies, to steer his students to take Portuguese and pursue Brazilian studies. This type of demonstrable support was evidence of his penetrating, I would say, professional vision and his belief in nurturing an academic sense of community by sharing, cooperating, and collaborating. Tom was famous for making public statements that sometimes got him into trouble, as we all know, especially when he, you know, very courageously spoke out against the military regime in Brazil. However, in the realm of public and open statements, I remember Tom consistently vocalizing his sharp wit, for he was an inherently quick read. For example, I remember Tom as guest on the Brazilian Joe Schwartz TV talk show, when he astounded the public and the host in Portuguese with his incisive yet funny quips that even challenged the host, the comic host. In thinking about Tom's sense of humor over the years, It comes to my mind that perhaps Tom Skidmore was actually a closet comedian who secretly wanted to do stand-up. In order to convey another side of Tom that always struck me as admirable, giving, and inspiring, I will close with one very memorable incident, which I think took place in this very room almost 30 years ago. No, 25 years ago, 30 years, who knows. And it occurred in November. No, I guess it wasn't 30 years, it was about 15 years ago. In November of 2005, 2004, I wasn't sure, during Brown's campaign for academic enrichment, at a formal dinner, honoring a member of distinguished donors to Brown. One of the generous donors being honored was Donald, not Trump, Donald Saunders, class of 1957, who happened to be accompanied by his wife, the Norwegian actress Liv Ullmann. For the couple, it was clearly Saunders' evening. After a dinner of long speeches, several individuals stood up to thank Brown for the impact that the university experience had upon their lives. While the event was pleasant enough, it started to get a little stuffy and repetitive. In the midst of all this manifest thanksgiving, Tom Skidmore bounced up and cleared the air by stating, "I don't know about all of you here this evening, but I'm extremely thankful for Brown University for putting me in the same room as Liv Ullmann." With that statement, Tom brought the house down. Everyone stood up and gave Liv Ullmann a resounding applause. And while I, too, applauded, I knew I was also applauding Tom for being the vibrant, generous, and unpretentious man and colleague whom I've gotten to know very, very well and had the honor of knowing. And that's my view of the man I wanted to share with you this afternoon. I'm grateful for having Tom as a memorable part of mine and my colleagues' lives. And so Tom Skidmore will be remembered, yes, for his intellectual accomplishments. But for me, and perhaps most importantly, for his boundlessly humane stature. And so, as we say in Portuguese, recebe muito obrigado, Tom, e recebe grande abraço. Thank you.
And now I apologize again, Nelson, for some final words by this. Before some final words by the Skidmore family, I'd like to call to the podium Harriet Hamassi, the Brown University librarian.
It's a pleasure to be part of today's program. In reflecting on the wonderful gift that Tom and his family gave to the Brown Library in 2006, as Robert mentioned, over 6,000 books and his own personal papers as well. And I often think, what is a scholar without a library, and what is a library without scholars? Tom gave a gift that reflected his own scholarly life and really planted for other students that would follow him, as well as fellow faculty and other scholars, an opportunity to observe his own intellectual life. It's an interesting thing to observe a person's collection. We've had many opportunities to receive personal collections. Sometimes they are actually collections that are not nearly as welcome as Tom's was to our library. This collection is unique in many ways and serves as the foundation, the intellectual foundation, for what has become our Brasiliana collection. So I want to say thank you also to the family for establishing an endowment in memory of Tom. We've received a number of gifts over the last few months, and this collection lives in a way that I understand you to say how Tom continues to live. So thank you very much.
One of Tom's sons, James Skidmore, will now be speaking.
First of all, Jim, thank you so much for organizing this, and Ramon, thanks to you as well. And there couldn't be a better person to be the Carlos Manuel de Cespedes Professor of History here at Brown than you. I'm going to keep this short, as I've been telling people I'm going to do. My father came here in 1988, and my brother and I drove out for that first Christmas vacation. I can't remember why we did that at that time. It was a good idea.
Like a good idea.
That's right, yeah. So we were dealing with some weather, and then we got up early in the morning for the second leg of the trip, and we were looking at the news, and it was a terrible event. It was the downing of the Pan Am flight in Lockerbie, Scotland. And I was looking at all this wreckage on the TV, and I thought, oh God, could this be a bad omen? And it wasn't. I needn't have worried. My dad had a great time here. He loved being at this university. It was a great second place for him, great place to retire. He loved building the program here. And we've talked before about how much he loved sports, and he was so ensconced, he loved the Red Sox and the Patriots when they were here. And it's a bit sad he didn't get to see the Chicago Cubs become the champions, because he would take us down there for games from Madison, and it was always a ritual. And my brother remembers we would stop by the McDonald's there, which is no longer there. He would buy tickets from a guy who had them, and we'd go in there, and they were terrible, and we still loved it. But he did live to see the Boston Red Sox win the championship three times when he was here and a fan of that team. So that's wonderful. So it's great to see you all here. And I just wanted to emphasize that this was a great place for him to come to the second part of his life. And my mother loved it here as well. And we loved visiting. And he made great new friends here. And as I said, loved building the program. And so thank you for being here at this great university, where he loved teaching. And I'm going to turn it over to my brother Dave for a few extra remarks.
Thanks very much. Thanks again to Jim Green. Can't say how wonderful you are. Brick sidewalks, curbs made of cut stone, clapboard walls, mullioned windows, steeples, cupolas. The power of place for a small boy, the feel of New England. I was born in Boston when my parents were at Harvard. So the very stones of this part of the world speak to me. We grew up in the Midwest. It's a place that I love very much as well. But there we pour concrete for sidewalks and curbs, and we miss out on the undulations of the walk beneath us as the tree roots grow. What must have been my father's journey like for him, his journey of learning? From Cincinnati, as a Midwestern boy, to Denison University, a simulacra of Harvard and the other eight colonial colleges, which themselves were simulacra of Oxford and the other great universities of the old world. It would have been a sense of wonder. And that's a sense that he brought to the study of history as well, which is, after all, stories, and is, after all, time travel. And what's the proper response in the face of time travel? Is it not wonder? And that's something he shared with us, all of us boys, and everybody. Never did roadside markers seem as interesting as when my father explained them. Look, boys, the United States Army took a break from murdering Indians right here on this riverbank. It seemed much more exciting than what was actually engraved on the marker itself. When he came to Brown, then, there was a sense of rightness for me coming back to the 9 colonial colleges, the oldest parts of our new world. Thank you all for taking us back. The old and the new colliding in his vigor and enthusiasm for Brazil. That's how I think about his career. We recently laid him to rest in Madison, along with Frederick Jackson Turner and Fighting Bob La Follette. It seems appropriate somehow. On his marker, it will say, "O velho texugo," the old badger. Old and new, with vigor, enthusiasm, and wonder. We will all miss him very much. Thank you.
And finally, Max Wilkinson, Tom's brother-in-law, will share some words with us.
Hi. I'm going to conclude by reading part of a poem that I wrote for Felicity's 80th birthday, which was on 30th of June. It was, of course, not long after Tom's death, and that's why I'm reading it now. So the poem is called On Felicity's 80th Birthday. This celebration of your 40 years is filled with memories of Tom, whose peers from many lands now honor his renown for scholarship imbued with wit, set down with limpid judgment and expected grin with which the prof would draw his listeners in. That questioning and slow, delightful smile, which we, his family, must mourn a while, the loss of all his wicked jokes and more, his lifelong voyage in search for truth, whose shore he often sighted through the mist and flow of circumstance. The Tom we knew and know endures in many legacies, and so your birthday, Bib, can truly be a time for happy recollections. He remains a towering influence, benign and smiling on us through the mists of time. I think he'd say, "That's quite enough on me. It's time for you to fade, Felicity." So, dearest Bib, it seems a kind of fraud to claim you're 80. Records, I'm assured, confirm the data. Although, to look at you, no one would guess, especially if they knew your powers of alchemy, still much enrolled in turning academic lead to gold, through 6 decades of love as wife and mom that you have dedicated to your Tom.
And now I would like to thank you all for being here today, and we will be posting this video online through the Brazil Initiative so you can share with your friends, and we would now like to invite all of you to enjoy us in a nice reception. Thank you very much.